I'm going to do something that may be a little bit out of character. It's not in my notes, but I want you to do something today and the remainder of this feast that you might not be very comfortable with. Okay? Do I have any Maple Leaf fans in here?
No.
Show of hands. Come on. What about the Blue Jays? Okay. You know, I asked that question because where I come from, everybody from Texas is a Cowboy fan, right? Except me and my family, we're the Texans fans. And what I find most embarrassing to us is that we can fill stadiums with 100,000 people and they will stand on their feet and they will scream for their favorite team, but they'll come into church and we'll sit on our hands. Can we do something different?
Yes.
Pastor Ramakan talked about the kingdom of God. We heard Pastor Harain speak about the temple, the celebration. And yet, I refuse, brethren, and I want you to develop this attitude as well. I refuse to let the mainstream world outpraise their favorite team. Then we give the praise to God and His Son, Jesus Christ. Do we have anything to be grateful for?
Yes.
Thankful for? Well, give Him glory. Give Him glory. For He is worthy to be praised. And He deserves your utmost honor. The title of today's message is, We Were Born to Live. We were born to live. This afternoon, we are to be encouraged with the words of life given to us by Jesus Christ Himself. We must first regain our focus on God's will for the life of mankind. We are living, brethren. We are living right now to inherit eternal life through the grace and mercy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Lord Jesus Christ made a bold and telling statement. We must thoroughly examine in order for us to be fit for service and love. Notice what I said. We're here to learn how to be fit for service and love. God is love. We are king priests. We're already given a down payment of what is to come. Prince and princess already. That's what you are. That's what I am. Now, we're being fit for service and love, as is the good and perfect will of God, our Father in heaven. Let's go to John chapter 10. I want to examine this statement made by Jesus Christ Himself, our Lord. In this verse, we're going to find some very key elements that I want to point out. John chapter 10 and verse 10, the thief cometh not but for to steal and kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. I have a question. What is life more abundantly? Life is our Father intended for us from the very beginning. Have you thought about that? Have you ever considered that? What is life more abundantly? And He came to, or so that we might have life. God created mankind to live forever. God created mankind to live forever. Yet, sin entered into the world and separated us from God and his nature and his characteristics. Sin entered in and separated us from God and his nature and his characteristics. We are here to learn how to exercise the godly nature and how to exemplify the godly characteristics. Amen?
Amen.
Shay just said in his prayer that we could be attracting lights. You know how we attract others? Exemplify the example that Jesus Christ and his Father gave us. And we could take all day talking about Jesus Christ and the example and think about all the many wonderful things he's done for you and what he's done for me. But that's what attracted all of us to being called and to be in this way and walk of life. So I want you to consider this for a moment. There were two trees in the Garden of Eden. One, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and the other, the tree of life. Now notice in Genesis chapter 2, I want to share something with you before I go any further. You know what confirmation is? Pastor Ramakan, did you and I talk about what we were going to speak about?
No, we
did. Did we share scriptures?
We did.
Did you take us to Genesis and end in Revelation? You might see that come to fruition in this message as well. Yes, sir. I want to tell you something. We have neglected the gifts of the Holy Spirit for far too long. And I'm going to share with you some things that are so clear. They're right under our nose. That God wants us to learn this feast. See, it is about giving, but it's also about what God has to give you. As Pastor Hendricks pointed out, we are at what? Our appointment with God. You know why we have these appointments? Because God also wants to impart something, his knowledge, his wisdom, his gifts, his mercies unto us. And we need to start expecting miracles and healings in the name of Jesus. Okay? So, Genesis chapter 2. I want to look at verse 9. As we talked about considering these two trees in the Garden of Eden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. Verse 9 says, "And out of the ground made the eternal God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. For the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the knowledge and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." Skip down to verse 16. "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat of it. For in the day you eat thereof, you shall surely die." Now, I want us to make note of something very crucial to our understanding. This that's pointed out in verse 16 is very crucial to your understanding of God's plan for mankind. God had a plan for mankind before the foundation of the world was laid, brethren. Look at verse 16. And let's look at this very carefully. My daughter's 8 years old and she watches cartoons and Blue's Clues. Little children, you know about the Blue's Clues? Okay, what's going to happen next? Here's a blue clue. Verse 16. Listen to what God told you and I. Listen to what he told Adam before he was created. Verse 16. "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, If you look at it in another translation, you know what it says? God commanded man to eat from the tree of life. Brethren, God commanded man to eat from the tree of life. Now, let's go to Genesis chapter 3. Show you something here. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yeah? Notice how he approached the woman. Yeah. Hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Brethren, God is in the details. We have a very meticulous God. People have tried to turn the world upside down and say that Satan is in the details or the devil is in the details. Have you heard that? Yeah. Throw it away. Because the devil is not in the details. The devil misses the details. He tried to get our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but he left the details out and Christ corrected him. Okay? So, listen to what the woman said in verse 2. We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. He never said not to touch it. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. I have a question for you. Why did Satan want mankind to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil first? Why didn't Satan entice mankind to eat of the tree of life? Have you ever thought about that? There were two trees in the middle. I just showed you in Genesis chapter 2 where God said of the tree of life he commanded you could eat. God intended for man to live forever. Brethren, we were born to live forever. Okay? So now, look at this closely. He says, this is simply because the tree of life is what God intended for mankind to have free access to from the very beginning. Have you ever noticed mankind was not forbidden to eat of the tree of life? Had you ever thought about that? Had you ever contemplated it? It has always been Satan's plan to steal, kill, and destroy. And that is his desire, and he will relentlessly attack mankind to pursue his quest. Satan wants mankind to take on his nature instead of us allowing God to develop in us the godly nature and the godly characteristics fit for king priest. We are to have godly nature and godly characteristics. Now, do you think you can become a king priest if you don't act like Jesus Christ acted? If you don't have his characteristics about him? I tell you about Queen Elizabeth, her children, her grandchildren that are getting ready to second and third in line into the throne, William, Charles. From the moment they are born, what do they learn? How to be king. The daughters learn how to be queen. Brethren, from the moment you are born, you learn how to be king priest. From the moment you are born again, we have to develop the godly nature and the godly characteristics. Okay? Notice what God says as a result of mankind's disobedience. Still in Genesis chapter 3, let's look at verse 22. And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us to know good and evil. Now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. See, this is what God said. He never, never had God forbidden us to eat of the tree of life. This is what he says. lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. What if Adam would have listened to God from the very beginning and ate from the tree of life and never touched the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Mankind would have lived forever. Now, verse 23 says, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the garden, at the east of the Garden of Eden, cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. God put his angels to keep the way of the tree of life. Notice he didn't destroy the tree of life. Have you ever paid that close attention to what's going on? He did not destroy it. He sent his angel to preserve the tree of life. Brethren, Satan's actions delayed God's plan, but they never changed God's plan for mankind to live forever and to have eternal life. Brethren, we were born to live forever. My friends, now is the time for us to regain our focus of why we were created in the very first place. Ever since Satan witnessed God create mankind in his own image and in his own likeness, Satan has waged war on God's creation. Make no mistake, brethren, we are at war right now, every single day. We are under attack by the most relentless enemy known to mankind, Satan and his demons. Now, most of mankind, to include Christians, do not realize we're at war, because the war we are constantly battling in is a spiritual warfare. We are constantly engaged in a spiritual warfare. I will give you 3 points needed to overcome this war and to fulfill God's will for mankind. Turn to Romans 4. Wherefore, my brethren, Wherefore, my brethren, you also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that you should bring forth fruit unto God. Verse 4 contains a key to our spiritual freedom and spiritual victory in Christ. What does the verse tell us? First, it tells us that we are married to Christ and that we are freed from the law. What law? The law that required the death penalty. For the wages of sin is death. But it also says we are to be married to Christ. We are married to Christ. We're free from the law. And then he says that you should go forth and bring fruit unto God. What are these fruits that we are to be bringing unto God? I think a lot of people have wrongly thought that the fruit that we are to bring unto God is to go out and convert the whole world, bring everybody to God. But do you know what those fruits are that we are to bring unto God? The godly nature and the godly characteristics? Galatians 5. We'll get to the fruits in just a moment. I promise I won't keep you on the hook very long. But I want to look at Galatians 5 so you can understand what it means to bring fruit unto God. Galatians 5, verse 16 through 18. This I say then, walk in the Spirit. We are to walk in the Spirit of God. And if you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Now, but if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Point number one, recognize we are at war. If you look at this verse right here that we just looked at, walk in the Spirit so that you can overcome and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh and the spirit against each other, war against each other. The flesh lusts against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. They are contrary to one another. But if we are king, priest, prince, and princess, as we are, we're led by God's Holy Spirit, right? So we have the freedom from the law. Romans chapter 7. Galatians 5:19, the next verse. I want to make sure everybody understands this war that we're dealing with. It says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. These are the works of the flesh. This is Satan's nature. These are the things that are contrary to the godly nature, the godly characteristics. Romans 7, verse 5, dealing with this warfare that we're in, says, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. Every tree which brings not forth fruit is cut down and cast into the lake of fire. You know that verse? Hold your places in Romans, and let's look at that. Because Christ said something to us about these trees. He talked to us about the fruit. And I want to make sure that it's crystal clear the difference between the fruits of the Spirit, which is the godly nature and the godly characteristics, and the sinful nature and the fruits of Satan, the devil. So, this is what Christ says in Matthew 7, verse 17. Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit. We are those good trees. We're here to bring forth good fruit. Those fruits of the Spirit. Those gifts of the Holy Spirit. He says, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. Now notice in Galatians, as I read, all the works of the flesh. That's corruption. Those are things that lead to destruction. He says, but Christ says in verse 18, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that brings forth not good fruit is cut down and cast in the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. You ever encounter people at work, in the neighborhood, out and about, and right away, you don't want to be around them. You can sense that there's something evil about them. And you right away, God's Holy Spirit enters and says, get away from them. Separate yourself from them. You're able to recognize that evil right away. Turn back to Romans chapter 7, verse 6. But now we are delivered from the law, that being dead, wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit, and not in the oldness of the letter. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. No. Had I not known sin, but by the law, for I had not known lust, except the law had said, you should not covet. But sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. For without the law, sin was dead. For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And the commandment which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. Which I already talked about. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 7, I want to look at verse 11 and continue to deal with this here. This is showing us what the Apostle Paul understood about recognizing being at war. And these next few verses are crucial. He says in verse 11, for sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and it slew me. Wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just and good, was then that which is good made death unto me. God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceedingly sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would that I do not, but what I hate that I do. If then I do that which I would not, I consent that the law is good. Now, then is it no more I that do it, but the sin that dwells in me? For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwells nothing good. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. There's a war going on. A battle to do right. A battle to overcome the works of the flesh. To choose life. To choose to do the will of God. And Paul understood that. And he was talking about the sin that we have been freed from. So he says here in verse 21, I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. There's a war going on inside every one of us right now. Think about it. I'm from Texas, right? We drive on freeways that are crowded and packed. You wonder how many times in the major city, the fourth largest city in America, that you get cut off. Right? What's the first thing comes through your mind? Right? You want to say something, honk your horn, or do something rude, right? But because Christ is dwelling in you, what do? You forgive right away. You forgive. You do not let that evil thought come to fruition. You take captive that thought and you put Satan behind you. But the attacks are still coming. It's something subtle like that. We don't always catch it, but that attack is always there. Now, he says in verse 24, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with my mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. He recognized that there was a battle going on. Paul tells us and he encourages us to fight the good fight. Brethren, this is a good fight. The fight of overcoming, just like our Lord Jesus Christ overcame. Think about when Jesus Christ was taken up by Satan and Satan tried to tempt him. Christ overcame him with the word of God each time. He never did evil for evil, right? Because Christ is that tree. He is the tree that we are all branches from. And he will not bear evil fruit. He never did. He's telling us not to bear evil fruit. Don't let Satan win those battles. Sometimes they seem meaningless, but they're not. Satan is trying to get you. The Bible tells us in so many places to do what? There's two things we're to guard constantly. You know what they are? Your heart and your mind. Because Satan is trying to get at that. Satan is trying to get at your mind, and Satan is trying to get at your heart. And I'm here to tell you, brethren, he can't have it. He can't have it. I want you to know that you have to always be on guard and you have to always be alert. There are things that are happening. There are change that is coming. And Satan is heating up his attack on you and I. The church has work to do. Much work to do. In order to witness. In order to warn. Go back and study what happened in the first century of the church. When they were doing a lot of witnessing and a lot of warning. There were things that were happening. So brethren, be on guard and always be alert. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11. Lest Satan should get advantage of us. For we are not ignorant of his devices. We're not ignorant of Satan's devices. The Holy Spirit, Christ, has given us a mind, a sound mind, a sober mind, a ready mind to serve him. So that we can be alert and we can be on guard and we are aware of Satan's devices. That's why the works of the flesh are in there. So that we'll know these are the works of Satan the devil. Christ himself said he was a murderer and a liar from the very beginning about Satan. He's the father of lies. And all these things are Satan's nature. It's with what Satan is trying to get us to partake of. But we are not Satan's children. Our father is the king. Can y'all say that? Our father is the king. Say it again. Our father is the king. Now say it like you mean it. Our father is the king. I still got some cowboy fans in here. It's serious, brethren. Our father is the king. There's none like him. There's nobody greater. There's nobody higher. Ephesians 4:27 says, neither give place to the devil. Don't give him any avenue to approach you. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 1 through 6. Now I, Paul, myself, beseech you, by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you, that I may not be bold when I'm present, with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. Notice what he says in verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to pulling down of strongholds. Ah, we have weapons. Paul wanted you and I to understand that we have weapons. And the weapons that we have are so mighty and so powerful, Paul says, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Now what do we do with these spiritual weapons? Verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Verse 5 is key. I told you, we are constantly in a spiritual warfare. And guess what? Christ gave us the tools to win the battle. And I need you to start thinking about this. I just want everybody to take one moment to think about what happened to you today. From the moment you got up to the moment we're in now. And ask yourself, did Satan try to attack you through one of these things? And if he did, here's the key to overcoming. Through the Spirit of the Holy Spirit of God. Verse 5. Casting down imaginations. Remember I talked about being on the freeway and somebody cutting me off? And what's the first thing I have to do? The thought comes in my mind, beep, 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 pull out the pistol, do something, right? You're laughing, but in Houston, at least once a month, someone is killed through road rage. I mean, people literally follow you home and shoot you. You know, I travel all over the United States, and when I'm in D.C., I'm always fascinated that you get to the light and everybody's beating on the horn. And I say to myself, that don't happen in Texas. Because in Texas, they kill you for something little like that. But what I'm trying to tell you, brethren, is use the weapons that God gave his king priest. Use the godly nature and the godly characteristics to overcome. So the first thing you have to do is, when those thoughts come to mind, whatever they are, cast them down. Because it's Satan, the devil, that is trying to get you. Look how subtle he came at Eve. Something simple about eating a piece of fruit. It says, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. What do you think the high thing is that exalts itself against the knowledge of God? Satan, the devil, and his demons. They're coming to try to steal, kill, and destroy so that you can't become king priest. But guess what? Every one of us. What did Christ say? When he presented himself to his father, he said, Lord, I got every one of them. Except the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. You know, God called each and every one of us. He draws us near his son. And I want to tell you something. If you don't think of yourself as special, think about this. God chose every one of you. Turn to your neighbor and say, God chose you. Turn to a different neighbor. God chose you. God chose you, brethren. It's quite humbling, isn't it? To think about it. God chose you for greatness. He chose you to become king priests. And he gave us the tools to make our calling and election sure. Now, he says, bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So, when that war comes on in your mind, what do? If it doesn't glorify God, what do with it? You cast it down. If it doesn't glorify God, you cast it down. You want to become attracting lights? You want the church of God to grow? These are the keys to doing it. Try it. It works. It's not easy, though, I'm going to tell you. I still have that urge when I get cut off. But I know I'm at a war. I recognize now I'm at war. And I know what's happening. And I'm going to tell you something, brethren. We have to take the attitude that we're not going to let nothing take away our crown and our robe. God chose you for greatness. He chose you to rule. He chose you to serve. And notice what Jesus Christ did. He took a beating beyond recognition. Did he ever one slap back? He could have. But he told his disciples, he said, when Peter cut off the ear, he said, Peter, shall I not drink of the cup that my Father prepared for me? Brethren, every one of us has to drink of that cup. And we have to share in that baptism that Jesus Christ shared in. And so we're going to have to be overcomers. And I need us to start acting like king priests. Why do we let the little things and the attacks of Satan tear us down? First thing I say to myself, my father's the king. Brethren, when Satan tries to attack you, say it. My father's the king.
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 Brethren, don't give up your crown. Don't give up your robe. Okay? Now, I want to show you some examples because I see I may have a few doubters in here on what I'm talking about. Matthew 5:28. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Oh, you mean that thought that came to mind? Young people, I was born in the church. I've been around my whole life. Fight those urges. Take into captivity every thought that is not in obedience to God and do what? Cast it down. Don't let that sin come to fruition. Stop it right there. Rebuke Satan the devil. What did Christ say? Get thee behind me, Satan. Stop those thoughts. Remember, we're chosen to be king priest. Okay? Now, Matthew 16:23. This is to the other ministers and myself. I have to remind myself constantly. Because we're in the ministry, we think we're strong, we're super, and yet Satan attacks us too. He attacked Peter. Did he not? So don't think because I've been a Christian for 46 years and I've been in this battle that I'm immune to being attacked. Because guess what? Verse 23 of Matthew 16, but he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you savest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Christ recognized that Satan was attacking Peter. And when Peter spoke, what did Christ say to him? Get thee behind me, Satan. He recognized the war. He recognized that wasn't the Spirit of God. That wasn't obedience to God. That was what? The sinful nature. The things of the fleshly man. And Christ immediately stopped them. Another example. James and John. Right? They had that zeal for God. They say, Christ, you know what? Why don't we just call down fire from heaven right now? And what did Christ say? Time out. Stop. You don't know what manner of spirit. Christ stopped that. He cast down those imaginations and he brought them all in obedience to his Father. Brethren, we are at war. I want you to understand something. Stop looking for ISIS. Stop looking for crisis other places. Stop looking for the stock market or the government to shut down or whatever you're looking at and start looking in the mirror and realize that Satan is after you. He doesn't want God's kingdom to come in fruition. You are the ones that are under attack. We're under attack. We're under attack daily. And we need to start putting on the whole armor of God. Look at verse 5 again. It says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Verse 6, having a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Christ says, if you love me, obey me. He says, I'll have obedience over sacrifice. He wants us to be obedient in him in all things. Now, number 2, overcome the works of the flesh by living in the Spirit and walking with God the Father. Number 1 was recognize you're at war. Number 2 is overcome the works of the flesh by living in the Spirit and walking with God the Father. Now we get to the things that God wants us to have, the godly nature, the godly characteristics, the higher calling. Galatians 5, verse 22. Galatians 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Ah, so we must have love. God is love, right? So if we're going to have godly characteristics and godly nature, the first thing we have to put on is what? Love. The godly love, the agape love, the brotherly love. That love that is not faked. That fervent love for one another. And that fervent love to do what? The will of the Father. You think it was easy for Jesus Christ to give his life for you and I? Do you really think it was easy? Go back and read what happened the moments before, how he was contemplating. He went and asked God if there be any other way. But you know what won in the end? Love. Jesus went to the cross for you and I for the love of the Father and to please his Father's will. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Joy. We're supposed to have the unspeakable joy. Peace. Long-suffering. Yeah, we're going to go through some things. We're king priests. We're going to inherit everything. And I have news for you. God has reserved for us, as the scripture says, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard. Brethren, no eye has seen the precious stones and ornaments that are going to be on your crown. No ear has heard what God has reserved for you and I. Gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. See, these are the things, king priests, the godly nature and the godly characteristics we're supposed to have. That's what God has given us through his Holy Spirit, through his Son. He says, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. So we're to walk in these fruits of the Spirit. My friends, family, that's the fruit that we are to bear much fruit of. And I have news for you. If we bear much fruit of these nine fruits of the Spirit, we will pack these rooms. We will pack stadiums.
Because guess what?
They will see, when they see us, they'll see the same thing Satan sees. You know what Satan sees when he sees you? He sees God. He sees the image and likeness of God, the one thing that he hates. We're his natural enemy because we bear the image and likeness of God the Father. These are the fruits of the Spirit. These are the tools that if we have in sufficiency in us, we will be those attracting lights. This is what we're to have. Now, James 4, verse 1. He says, James is talking to us and he says, from whence comes wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lust that war in your members? Why did all the apostles understand we were at war and we somehow have forgotten it? I know we knew it. I know we knew it. But somehow along the way we forgot it. We started focusing on the king and priesthood, and we forgot that there are certain elements, fruits of the Spirit, gifts of the Spirit that we must possess in order to be kings and priests. But these apostles understood it. These prophets, these Old Testament, New Testament, patriarchs. He said, even of your lust that war in your members. He says, you lust and you have not. You kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you have not because you ask not. You ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust. You adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. We're not to love the worldly things. So I'm hoping after today we don't have no more Cowboy fans and everybody in here becomes a Jesus fan. Amen?
Amen.
Now, do you think that the scripture says in vain that the spirit that dwells in us lusts to envy? But he gives more grace. Wherefore he said, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. This is what God wants us to do. Submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Those thoughts that you're casting down, and you're rebuking Satan the devil, and you're telling him to get behind you, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Another thing that you can do when you're being attacked by Satan the devil is put on your favorite spiritual music. Because that's what David had to do for Saul. Saul's spirit was vexed, right? And he had to send for David, and David had to come play for him to soothe him. See, there's a reason why we do praise and worship. And there's a reason why the young folk are trying to introduce contemporary worship. Because some of those songs, and I love them, been around as long as most people in here. Some have a few more years on me because they were adults already coming to the church. One man told me he came into church before I was born. So there's a few people that have a lot of time. But that song, By the Waters of Babylon, it meant something to the children of Israel. But the songs that we're singing today mean something to us. I'm in a different battle than they were in. You're in a different battle. And I need something more to lift up my spirit than what the children of Israel needed. Does that make sense? Don't quench the spirit, brethren. We need all kinds of music because we're from all walks of life. But guess what? God chose you. And he knew what you had with you. Right? He wants us to be joyful. He wants us to praise him. Verse 8 says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. He says, cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted, and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Eternal, and he shall lift you up. Point 3, use the spiritual weapons of warfare Jesus Christ gave us to overcome the enemy's tactics. I want to show you something. One of these days, some of you are going to scream and you're going to shout when you have the things happen to you that have happened to me or my wife or some of the other ones in who have shared your testimony. When you're freed from the strongholds of Satan the devil, you can't help but shout for joy. You can't hold your peace. You think Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you think they didn't realize what kind of situation they were in? When the fire was turned up 7 times hotter. And Nebuchadnezzar made a fatal mistake. He said, think about what you're doing here. But they were faithful children. They said, my father's the king. My father's the king. And guess what? They said, we don't even have to think about it. Because he is able to deliver us. But guess what? If he doesn't, we'll die before we serve or bow down and worship to your idol. They understood what was going on. And nothing was going to take their crown. Mark 3:27. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he will first bind the strong man and then he will spoil his house. Satan strongholds on you when you yield to temptation. Christ has given us power to loose Satan's strongholds and to bind them. My wife spoke about breaking those chains and tearing down those strongholds. Some of us have been walking around here tormented by Satan the devil and don't even realize it. Don't even know it. You're walking around here bitter. You're angry. You're hateful. You're resentful. You're full of envy and lust. And all the things that are the devil's nature. But guess what? Satan has attacked you. And little by little, he's gained a foothold, stronghold on you. Matthew 16, verse 19. Christ said, "And I will give you unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you shall bind on the earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on the earth shall be loosed in heaven." You know what he was telling him? I am going to give you the keys to bind the strongholds and to loose the strongholds. He never meant for Satan to be able to torment you. He told Peter, he said, "Satan has desired to sift you as wheat." You think Satan don't look at all of us like that? Do you not understand that Satan is trying to derail God's plan? He's trying to destroy King Priest. He's not worried about if we're looking at chess. He's not looking for the pawns. He's not looking for the rook or the knight. He's looking for the King Priest. And he's trying to bind you so that you can't do the works of God. Matthew 18, verse 18 through 20. "Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on the earth shall be bound in heaven." What was Christ talking about binding? Binding the strongholds of Satan that have been loosed. "And whatsoever you shall loose shall be loosed in heaven. And again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where there are two or three gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them." Brethren, battling against Satan's strongholds requires much faith. It requires belief. And it requires fasting and prayer. For time's sake, you can look at the example in Mark 9. I won't turn to it. We'll skip on to it. Skip on about it. But in your spare time, I want you to look at that. Because Christ was dealing with something there. And his disciples asked the question, why couldn't we deal with this? He said, because these type come forth by nothing but fasting and prayer. He intended for them to tear down those strongholds, to bind them, to deal with them. Matthew 17, verse 19. "Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, why could not we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief." I want you to look at that for a moment, church, because I got brethren in here that have been around for quite a long time. And Christ was talking to his disciples that he had sent out to cast out demons. And the disciples said, "What was the problem, Jesus? What did we do wrong?" Jesus said unto them, "Because of your unbelief." Brethren, you got to believe. You got to believe that God gave us the power to do these things. These are the weapons of war that he gave us. His witnesses on the face of the earth to warn the world of the coming wrath. We are going to the kingdom. But the wrath is coming on this world. Brethren, there is a wrath to come. And we should be warning and witnessing against that. But he says that, "For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible for you." Like my wife said, I'm possible. It's not impossible. Nothing is impossible through the Spirit of God. "Howbeit this kind goes not out but by prayer and fasting." Pastor Ramakan said something. He said, "If you got good news and you don't share it, that's not good." Right? So as I close this, I will share the last of the good news. We will defeat and overcome the sinful nature of the devil if we repent and walk in the Holy Spirit. We will. And many of you are on a daily basis. But I need the whole church to do that. We need to be working in unison. Because I've heard it as I go around preaching in different congregations. I've heard people say, Satan come to church too. Satan come in the room too. And you know how he come in? We bring him. Through bitterness, through resentment. Things that we should have cast down and recognized that we was in war. When you come into the temple, into the sanctuary, don't bring nothing but your heart and your mind to serve God. John chapter 12, verse 31 and 32. Jesus Christ left us something great. He said, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Satan has been judged. The enemy has no power over you, brethren. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. But you have to recognize that you're in warfare. Romans 16, verse 19 and 20. For your obedience has come abroad unto all men. I am glad, therefore, on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. Listen to what he says in verse 20. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet, under my feet. Brethren, we can tear down those strongholds. We can break those chains. We can bind Satan and we can loose those who have been bound by Satan. But we got to believe, brethren. Because the world is counting on us. God called us to be his servants. And I heard Pastor Horain on the first night say, serve, give, not just try to receive, but give also. What are we to give as king priest, as prince and princess? What are we to give? Give ourselves. Give freedom. Give understanding. He says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Colossians 2, verse 10. Notice what he says to us here. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also you are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, whom hath raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. You know what he took away from us? The sinful nature. Satan is not going to win this battle, and he's not winning with you. He's not winning with me. Now I need you to have more victories. And I believe you will have more victories now that you know that you're at war and you know what weapons to use. She said, pray on. Pray on. For this is where the battle is won. Pray without ceasing. Pray in the Spirit. And God will give you deliverance, brethren. Verse 15, he says, and having spoiled principalities and powers. Who spoiled them? Christ spoiled those strongholds, those principalities, those powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. King Jesus, brother, our Savior, the captain of our salvation, has equipped us to ensure that we get the victory and we overcome the enemy. Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't share this with you. It's difficult when you're young in the ministry and you grew up in the church. People don't always see you as the way God sees you, or the way God is using you, or the way God is allowing you to be tested. But I'm going to share something with you that the Holy Spirit shared with me. And every one of you will be encouraged by this. And I pray that after hearing these words of life, you'll never be the same. That your battle will be a victory. And that you will smash Satan under your feet. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 6, he says, "Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that you stir up the gift of God." Brethren, I was sent here to stir up the gift of God in you. The gift that each of you already have, the fruits of the Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, so that you can utilize them on a daily basis and overcome Satan the devil. He says, which was put in you by laying on of hands. He says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear." Oh, anxiety. Anybody get nervous when it's time to sing or when it's time to give the message? He didn't give us the spirit of fear. You get nervous when you do something or something, you fear the power of the unknown. He says, "For he did not give us the spirit of fear." Notice that fear is called a spirit. It's a spiritual attack that Satan uses on you. Fear, fear, fear. He tries to get us. Those are the kind of weapons that he used against us. But he says he gave us power. What's the first thing that we find again? Love. "But of power and of love and of a sound mind, be you therefore ashamed of the testimony, be not you therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be you a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God." The sufferings, the attacks, that's going to come. But he says, "Who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not into according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began." Oh, we were born to live. God did indeed intend for us to live forever. "But is now manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who abolished death and have brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Where am I appointed? I am an appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of to the Gentiles." This is what Paul encouraged Timothy with. "Brethren, let your spirit be stirred up, that you may overcome these battles. The latter rain is coming, brethren." Does anybody know what the latter rain is? The latter rain is coming. The outpouring of God's Holy Spirit spoken of by the prophet Joel. The latter rain is coming, brethren. And the spiritual gifts and the fruits of the Spirit will be evident in the church of God, and we will be attracting lights. And we will win these battles on a daily basis in victory through Jesus Christ. Now notice the end of the story, because we started in Genesis with the tree of life. And Pastor Ramakan, I was smiling as he was finishing his sermon. He looked at me. Why does this guy keep smiling at me? He didn't know I said, "My God, how great you are." Revelation 22. Verse 1 through 6. We were born to live, brethren. "And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of the street, and on either side of the river was there the tree of life." Satan's actions did not change God's plan for mankind to live forever. Jesus Christ came that we might have life, and that we might have life more abundantly. From the very beginning, he was slain before the foundation of the earth. And it was such so that God's plan could come to fruition. What does he say? The tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Pastor Ramakant is going to give a message to the nation on the last great day. The leaves of the tree. And there shall be no more curse. But the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. And his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face. And his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there, and no need of candle, neither of light of sun. For the Lord God give them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. And he said unto me, brethren, we were born to live forever. We will taste that fruit of the tree of life, just as God intended for mankind to do from the very beginning. Sin entered into the world and it delayed God's plan, but it did not change God's plan. Brethren, we are overcomers. We're conquerors. Now you understand why Paul said we're more than conquerors. We're more than overcomers. Because we're conquerors and we're overcomers of fighting the strongholds and the principalities of Satan, the devil, who wants to steal, kill, and destroy us. And he said unto me, these sayings are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Brethren, for the remainder of your feast, let us focus on the good and perfect will of God. We were born to live forever. Let us pray, thy will be done.